on the merits of their business. So this is a this is a neighborhood in the northeast portion of the Mission that is characterized by an interplay of existing housing stock as well as as PDR uses. We adjoin the one of the main SF Muni barns on the other side of 16th Street. As I shared with you, just south of us is the old Kilpatrick's Bakery itself. That's now occupied by Hampton Creek, which is a manufacturer of vegan mayonnaise. And then if you notice the yellow building, that yellow mass, it's just south of that. Those buildings represent our 2060 Folsom project. And immediately south of that is new green space in the form of the Inchakal Park that opened up on June 23rd of this year. So as I shared with you, our vision is to replace the PDR on a one-for-one basis. So you can see how our ground plane starts to reflect that in terms of configuration of that PDR space and the redistribution of that. So we are presently proposing not an 8,900 square foot replacement, but rather approximately 13,000. So we're going to do a little bit better than presently exists on site. And we're going to reconfigure the site so that we can have a much more active ground floor. So moving up above that, you start to see the residential articulate itself. So we started by thinking about how we can accommodate as much residential as we could. And so this was the initial thinking with really amassing of the majority of the residential along 16th Street, and then feathering to lower heights as we get deeper along the Shotwell frontage into the towards 15th Street. And so as proposed, we're proposing an eight-story building with approximately 143 units. 50% of those, as I shared, are going to be two and three bedrooms. This is primarily a family-oriented project. We've got approximately 11,500 square feet of residential open space. We're going to have 5,000 square feet of affordable childcare. And again, as I shared with you, our PDR, the replacement, our threshold at a minimum is a one-for-one, but at present, we're beating that, and we intend to continue to beat that. So, as we thought about this project, we really wanted to hit a sweet spot because we have to think not just about the sustainability of the financing. So financing is obviously something that we have to think about because we are long-term owners. We have a fiduciary responsibility to our partners to ensure that we're meeting our financial obligations. But beyond that, we have obligations to the communities that we serve. So we have to think about value creation in multiple ways. So we're not just focused on a bottom line, on a profit metric, however you want to construe that. We're really thinking about how do we balance culture, how do we balance program, how do we balance neighborhood, and knowing that this is a neighborhood in transition and it's changing. How do we honor what exists and look at what is coming to the fore as the neighborhood evolves? And so specifically, as we think about that from a design perspective, we really wanted to take a look at, again, what was around us. What is, how does the neighborhood work right now? And as I shared with you, we've got some larger building massing, interspersed with smaller scale, with the smaller scale architectural language of the city. So 4 to 25 unit Victorians, so small buildings, that are interwoven with the larger PDR commercial buildings. And so that means that there's a changing kind of a patchwork quilt of design languages that exist within the community. But it's also one that is very much defined by the integration of art and the use of art to engage and to give voice to concerns within the community. So as we think about that, we wanted to reflect that and really make sure that folks understood this building is a series of poems. This is a family building. It's not we're not here to design production widgets. These are poems, and we intent, we want to make sure that folks understand that and that the design starts to reflect that. And so as we take the larger massing, what we wanted to do was break that apart and articulate a language that reflects home, that reflects family, that reflects the values of the communities that we are trying to serve. Wanted to make sure that we were able to relate the different functions of the rooms on the exterior of the building, so that you can tell that this is a bedroom, this is a family room, this is who is here, families, children, joy. And so as we do that again, we continue to introduce variety to remind passersby that this is a family project, but also to break up the massing. And to better situate the building within the scale of the fabric there at our location. And so we do that with a variety of exterior materials and color palettes. The color palettes for us are very much reflective of the vibrancy of our communities within the mission. We get folks that come from all over the world to visit our murals, and they're used to those pops of color. May not necessarily understand the history of that language, but we obviously recognize that continuity. We want to engage in a conversation with that and reflect that in what we're proposing for 1994. And so as we start to break apart the building, we also want to integrate, we're proposing to integrate our outdoor spaces in a way that, that again, honor the families that we're serving and reflect the uses that are within. And so if you notice what we've done on the 16th Street facade, and I'm a little bit farther away, but the major massing of the building is broken up by that green area, and that actually that is a series of studios that atop the second level is perforated by an extension of our second floor podium outdoor space, and so our resident outdoor space is connected visually to the street. And so that allows for circulation of fresh air, that allows for again, further reduction of the mass of the building, and an integration of green at multiple levels for the pedestrians that casually pass by the building, as well as residents that experience the building. And so integrated within our green spaces will be a series of rooftop gardens at the top, and then at the podium level, have some functional spaces as well. So this gives you an idea of what the existing conditions are right now at the intersection of Shotwell and 16th Street, and what we're proposing and how that massing works. So quite a bit different, we recognize, and so as you can tell, as I shared with you earlier, we've got townhomes in the back that flank the south side. I'm sorry, the north side of the building, and the north side of our resident open space, the main resident open space at the podium level. Immediately on the Shotwell side as well, you can't really tell, but our childcare facility is proposed for the Shotwell front. As Shotwell has lower vehicle count, it's a calmer street, and that. Orientation works in tandem with the proposed 2060 Folsom project, which will be under construction next year, which also situates its childcare on the Shotwell side of the street. So we'll have two childcare facilities that will be operating within a block of each other, probably half a block. And this building is going to have that facility a block away from the new park that just opened as well. So we want to make sure that we're really thinking about how children will be using that, about how families will be using the Shotwell frontage of the building. At the ground level on 16th Street, we've broken up the PDR spaces to really reflect the variety of uses that will be that are proposed within the ground plane, and then the main residential entry unit entry is going to be below that that multicolored patch that you see, which represents the view corridor into the second floor podium. And so this is the corner of 16th Street and Folsom right now, and this is 16th and Folsom as proposed. And so as we talk about, to kind of draw your attention to that courtyard portal, we're taking inspiration less from the existing language of art within the community and kind of drawing from a deeper palette, from a deeper mural tradition that reaches across Latin America, and hopefully we can use that as a focal point to engage community and continue conversations about just about place and the meaning of place. So this perspective gives you a little bit of a view of what we have planned for the second floor podium. You'll notice that we have a sunken ground level courtyard as well. We provide a number of different use options for the podium, including a reading area that's a little bit more quiet and meditative, a more active play area that joins our child care, which will have its own play area at ground level. Resident child care will be at podium level, and we're also proposing resident daycare units, and so those daycare units are going to be located adjoining the play area on the podium level. So again, this is just a further kind of diagram of the building itself, and want to just kind of talk a little bit about the existing conditions of Folsom Street. This is so 16th Street and Folsom are, and 16th Street rather in particular, has been identified as one of the Vision Zero corridors. 22 Fillmore Project is a Vision Zero project, and so there are a number of improvements that are being that are currently nearing final design along 16th Street. And so if you notice, we've got 10 on-street parking stalls. We've got a number of existing curb cuts that were designed to serve the existing building. And what we're proposing is to maintain the existing count of parking stalls on street, but to modify the layout, reduce the number of curb cuts so that the building can still function for its PDR users, but we're reducing conflicts for pedestrians and for cyclists. So this is the proposed ground level program. We're introducing, again, as I shared with you, we've got loading on Shotwell. We've got white zones proposed adjoining the bus bulb out at 16th Street and Folsom. And then we're also proposing to increase the number of shade trees along all frontages of the building. So I'll close with a quick bit of background about where we are in the process and kind of what we're doing. As I shared with you, we started this project last year, and so we we're presently in the middle of a series of community meetings. We had our first large community meeting last October, our second one this past May, and we're continuing to do a number of small groups on an invitation basis, as well as focus groups. We had our special use district proposed and initiated by Supervisor Ronan in June of this year, and we are that proposed legislative amendment is scheduled to be heard by the Board of Supervisors Land Use Committee on October 2nd. The project itself is scheduled to go before Planning Commission on September 28th of this year. If all goes well, we anticipate that we will be beginning the permitting process in the spring of next year, and we hope to be underway actually in early 2019 with delivery of the project in late 2020. So happy to answer any questions that you might have. Yes, sir.
My favorite subject is what's underneath you.
Mission Creek is right next to us.
Yeah. Sand dunes, rubble from 1906. Very, very collected variety down there. Are you in a liquefaction zone?
So we are in a liquefaction zone. So we're going to be having a number of piles. So our foundation system is going to consist of a series of piles as well as soil improvements to the soil to allow us to ensure that we're not vulnerable or less vulnerable.
How deep are your piles going?
That's a good question. I'd have to ask my geotech team. I can have an answer.
Just send me the report.
Yep, I'm happy to do that as well.
The reason I am because we had here a while back a person from the city talked about sea level rise. Mm-hmm. And my area of interest is what sea level rise went through the groundwater. Mm-hmm. And if the projections come true, now they're talking about how Stinson Beach is going to disappear in 2050. Mm-hmm. And that's almost 3 foot rise. Mm-hmm. So if the water level does run, groundwater goes up that far, is your pile going to be a groundwater or your basement going to be a groundwater?
So we're not proposing a basement. So we're actually proposing a finished floor that's 18 inches above grade. So as you astutely point out, we've got a high water table at the site ranging from 7 feet, I believe, at the Shotwell side, going to 2 feet on the Folsom side because of the way Mission Creek moves. And so we are responding to the existing soil conditions, the existing high water table, as well as the fact that we have stormwater management issues right there along Folsom that are hopefully going to be ameliorated by the proposed investment in an enhanced stormwater system down Folsom, but that project is in the early design stages, and so as we understand, it's not scheduled to be implemented until 2024 at the absolute earliest. So that means that we still have to make preparations and assume that project is going to go unfunded and just assume the worst so that we can be prepared for those conditions.
Have you thought about putting ground dewatering system in?
We've talked about that, and so at this point, our geotech team and our structural engineers have really felt that it would be prudent to think about ground dewatering during construction phases. But because we're not going to be doing a significant level of excavation, we're probably not going to really utilize ground dewatering technology, for a significant part, or to maintain, or for ongoing operations of the building. But yes, we certainly, that's been part of our ongoing discussions with our design team.
Yeah, so that's all in your view. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
I'm just curious. You had mentioned that the average family household income is around 31,000.
Great question. That's actually all of our units are tied to a bandwidth right around 50% of AMI in San Francisco. So in the city of San Francisco, so MoCD AMI is right around 82,000. So our deepest affordable units or our home for units we're setting aside 20% of which are formerly homeless are going to be priced right around 15% of AMI. So very, very, very affordable. And then we tier up to between 30 and 30 all the way up to 60% of AMI, just depending on qualification. But we're indexed to right around 50% of AMI. So
sorry, I'm not familiar with AMI.
Yeah. So area median income. Between 36,000 and $40,000 dollars for our that's kind of the income targets that we're looking at right now, and those are obviously subject to annual updates. But what does that mean? So actually, show you. So this gives you an idea of kind of who of what the different AMIs look like. So at a 55% AMI, paraprofessional, preschool workers, security guard. That's a assistant manager at a retail